Hello everyone, my name is Alan Bustamante and I am a senior Agile consultant here at CPON Software. I also lead the Agile Services team. We are going to be talking about Only the Agile Survive, Understanding the Business Case for Agile. So here's our agenda for today. We're going to talk about the new normal. And when I think of the new normal, I think of, you know, we've always been asked to do more with less. And it seems like since the Great Recession, we've been in, you know, asked to do even more with much less. So we'll talk about, you know, your worries as a manager or as an executive, your worries in context of the new normal. We'll talk about lessons learned from this context, as well as what is Agile, why would you consider Agile, and some of the changes you can expect from adopting Agile. Okay, so this is you. Right, you're a senior manager, you're an executive, you've got a lot of worries. Of course, you worry about your customers. You want to know, you know, how do we retain existing customers and how do we obtain new ones? Of course, if you're familiar with marketing and taking marketing 101, you know that it's always cheapest to retain your existing customers and always the most expensive to obtain new ones. Employees, yeah, how do we keep the best employees and how do we attract new ones? Shareholders. How do we create wealth for our shareholders? Market share. How do we enter new markets? How do we gain market share? Competition. How do we fend off our competitors and beat them to new business opportunities? And of course, profit and loss. You know, we want to increase profits while minimizing our losses. As you're operating your business in the new normal, you may have realized that business is changing, as the CEO of Nationwide did when he surveyed 36,000 of his employees, he realized that the biggest employer was technology. So we know that technology is driving competitive advantage for many organizations that have traditionally not been technology companies. And you may be seeing this in your own organization. I happen to know that Nationwide is an Agile shop and they've been adopting Agile for the past few years. You may have realized that the pace of innovation is up. You know, most recently we saw the release of the iPad 2. That was released less than 1 year after the iPad 1. Here we have an example of Android's law, where at the bottom we see the various releases of Android. They have funny names, so you know, Cupcake was released in April of 2009. We had Donut released in September of 2009, so 5 months later. 1 month later, Eclair was released. That was a major upgrade from 1.6 to 2.1. And then their latest release is Froyo from May of 2010. Now, the blue bars represent the manufacturer's response time to this new operating system. So for those of you not familiar with Android, it's Google's mobile operating system. With each release, manufacturers were able to catch up. They were able to improve their manufacturing cycle time so that they could not only, this is not upgrading the phone with the operating system, the new operating system, but in fact, manufacturing an entirely new phone that takes full advantage of the new operating system. With Android 1.5, we saw that it was a 9.7-month turnaround for a phone manufacturer to release a new phone that took full capability of that Android 1.5 operating system. By the time we got to Android 2.2, the cycle time was 6.7 months. So that's a full 31% increase in production and cycle time to produce a new phone. So we're not only seeing this increased cycle time for or decreased cycle time for producing software, but also for the hardware that goes along with it. In the new normal, we know employees have options. So Google recently announced that they will be adding 6,000 workers to their ranks. It's not uncommon for them to offer six-figure salaries to their employees. And you may be thinking, well, you know, this only applies to tech-oriented businesses. Well, remember Nationwide? You know, that's a business that traditionally has not been a tech-oriented business, but they're finding themselves increasingly so. So they're going to be competing for the same engineering talent that, you know, we see from the likes of Google, Facebook, and Twitter. So we know Agile is gaining strength. These are all organizations that we know very well that have adopted some form of Agile practices. And there's been various case studies done on a few of these. We know private companies are turning to Agile to help them remain competitive And we know that public sector organizations are turning to Agile to help them meet deadlines. So for instance, New York State, I happen to know of a case where a friend and a colleague of mine, Pat Griglia, who managed a project in New York State to replace a legacy highway data app. This was traditionally a waterfall organization, but the state of New York was under pressure to meet a deadline. They had to deliver a minimal set of functionality by this deadline in order to get the federal highway funding that they needed. And this was $1.56 billion, not million, billion dollars on the line for this project. You know, it wasn't an easy process, but he got them through the development process of delivering in an agile fashion, delivering incrementally, an organization that had traditionally been waterfall. And they were able to meet that deadline and get that $1.56 billion in funding. Vestas, I know them from my involvement in Houston. They're a windmill manufacturer. And they use Scrum and Agile practices not only for their software development, but also in the development of their windmills. I heard of these guys? This is the new voice of the customer, right? So we're in the social media age. We've got Facebook and Twitter at the top and YouTube at the bottom. There's also LinkedIn and a few other social networking sites. But as far as consumers go, this is probably the cream of the crop. And as Jeff Bezos said from Amazon, he said, if you make customers unhappy in the physical world, they might each tell six friends. If you make customers unhappy on the internet, they can each tell 6,000 friends. So we know that in today's world, in the new normal, the customer can make their voice heard in a very public and sometimes embarrassing way. You know, your product can go from hero to zero in a matter of minutes, maybe even seconds, if you're not in tune with what their needs are. So let's take an example, Dave Carroll's guitar. Dave is part of the band Sons of Maxwell, and he was on tour, happened to land in Nebraska, and as he looked out the airplane window, he noticed that the United baggage handlers were tossing his luggage around. And by the time he got to baggage claim, they found out that a few of their guitars were broken. You know, I can relate to this personally because I've traveled quite a bit for work, and you know, dealing with the customer service from the airlines is challenging at best. A lot of paperwork, a lot of forms you got to fill out, a lot of agents you got to talk to, an email, and that was the case with Dave. And after 9 months of trying to, you know, settle things with the airlines through their normal channels, they finally told him, look, we can't do anything for you. All he was asking for was $1,200 to repair his guitar. It was a $3,000 Taylor guitar. He just wanted $1,200 to pay for the repair, and he even admitted that even after the repair, it didn't sound the same, but that's all he wanted. Well, after 9 months, after no resolution, they told him, we can't help you. He said, I'm going to, you know, write 3 songs about my experience. And you can see here, the right of the slide, there's 3 songs there, and they're available from download from Dave's songs. I've got the URL there if you want to write it down. But after writing the first song and publishing it to YouTube, within 4 days, United stock plunged 10%. Now, this is an extreme case, right? They say here it costed shareholders $180 million. Can't really say for sure that all of that was attributed to Dave Carroll's incident, but we know that a portion of it was, and the PR machine did not respond well. The upside is Taylor Guitars, right? They landed themselves, as it says here in the Fast Company article, a PR windfall, and it actually created great publicity for them. So that social media outlet is sort of a double-edged sword. You know, if you're not treating your customers well, they're going to let you know. If you're on the positive end of it, then you may reap the rewards. All right, so let's talk about some of the lessons learned. So we know, as we saw on the previous slides, that technology is a source of competitive advantage. So regardless of the business you're in, so remember, nationwide companies are becoming more and more technologically advantaged. They're trying to get more value out of their software, their products. We know technology has to support corporate strategy. So I've been in many businesses where there's a separation there of business and IT. If we had to go talk to our product manager, business owner, product owner, whatever you want to call them, it was go talk to the business. IT is often looked at as a cost center. But really, we should be looking at it as an innovation center, because, you know, there shouldn't be this, you know, there's the business and there's IT, and IT is a cost. IT should be a source of innovation and should be working collaboratively with our business partners. So this is why, you know, with Agile, you know, our business, we have a product owner or a product manager that sits with us daily. It's a key ingredient of any Agile process. They sit with us and guide us and help us make sure that we're delivering the best thing, the best product possible. Often what happens is when you have separation, it leads to competing objectives that are not in the best interest of the entire organization. So we want to make sure that we look at technology as a strategic advantage and not as a cost center. So we've learned that there's a war for technology, right? Or technology talent that is heating up. So we saw that cool companies are hiring. The Facebooks, Googles, Amazons, those companies, they're hiring, and they're going to be hiring the best and the brightest. So where does that leave you? If you don't have the financial wherewithal to pay every college grad that comes into your organization six figures a year, you know, I think Google stock price was something like $600 a share. You can't, you know, woo them with a strong stock price. But then you have to look at other ways of attracting that talent. So you want to have a way of keeping your employees engaged and challenged through a healthy culture, and that will be key. And there's one thing I've learned. I've been around a while. You know, money really is a short-term motivator when the work environment is not good. So if you're not providing an optimal work environment for your future employees or current employees, they'll look elsewhere, and your best will find the better places, the better paying jobs. We also know that we've learned that information travels faster than ever before, a lot faster. You know, millions of opinions about your product or service will be heard within minutes or seconds. If you've been following the Charlie Sheen controversy, you might be aware that he just recently got himself a Twitter account. He posted a picture holding a chocolate milk jug, and this was some obscure dairy farm in California. Because he had drawn such buzz, and I forget the name of it, but this company had their phones were ringing off the hooks after he had posted this tweet. You know, so Charlie Sheen, who had never even been a Twitter member before, all of a sudden just signed on one day, posted this picture, and now this dairy farm is famous. So we've learned that information travels faster and faster every day. So we know our customers want to be heard. You know, we've learned they want to be heard for good or bad. Customers want to know you care. They want to know whether it's a complaint, that they want to know that you care, whether it's a complaint or a compliment. They want to know that you're listening to them. And lastly, we've learned that quality must be job one for organizations. So quality is a loaded word. We'll see it again shortly, but it must be perceived by the customer. And that gap between perceived quality and actual quality must narrow. If there is a problem with your product, you want to respond to them. Let's say the quality, you've got a defect, right? You want the quality of your service, your customer service organization must be up to par to address them. So you're a manager, you're an executive, maybe your background is in IT. Realize all these lessons you've learned, these things that are you know, coming out of the social media age and the new normal, and you decide, I need to have a discussion with IT. And when you talk to them, you hear all these funny words. You know, you hear extreme programming, makes you think of heliskiing or half piping on a skateboard, planing poker, scrum, increment, velocity. These may mean nothing to you. You wonder, what does this mean and how does this help me with my worries? Well, first let's talk about what is Agile. Agile is a set of values. Now this is directly from the Agile Manifesto website. So I encourage you to go out to agilemanifesto.org and read these. You'll see this and information around it. I pulled this quote, while there is value in the items on the right, we value the items on the left more. What that's saying is that, you know, in an Agile world, we value the things on the left, so the first row of items here, we have individuals and interactions over process and tools. And what that means is, you know, we want to be talking to each other daily. You know, for those of you who are working with scaled teams, you've got people in different locations. It doesn't necessarily need to be face-to-face, although we would have a preference for that. It just means that we want people, you know, talking to each other daily and adapting their work habits, rather than relying on email and a one-size-fits-all process. So I've been into plenty of organizations where they've got a PMO, a centrally centralized PMO, and there's that one size fits all process that's dictated down to the different teams. And in an agile world, what we want is more of a decentralized process. So we want each team to be able to adapt a process that delivers results, but is optimized for their unique situation. So we don't want to be dictating process from on high. We want to leave that up to the team. Next one, working software over comprehensive documentation. We want to prove our assumptions empirically, which means that we're showing something tangible from our work, something that we can release into a production environment. So show progress that way as opposed to comprehensive documentation, which if you're familiar with a traditional waterfall project, we do a lot of documentation up front based on a lot of assumptions, and we make it so that we're not even writing code until more than halfway through the project, if you assume a year-long project. Up until that point, we've got just a bunch of documentation, things that we may not even develop. So you can think of that as sunk cost. Customer collaboration over contract negotiation. So we want to talk to our customers daily so we understand how their needs are changing. We don't want to just throw things over the wall like we would on a traditional project where we meet, sign a contract, sign off on some requirements, throw it over the wall, and then 6-7 months later the customer comes back and tells us that that's not what they want. Now we want that collaboration constantly on a daily basis and rely less on the contract. And my experience has been, yes, contracts are necessary without a doubt, but when you have a very good relationship with your customer, that contract starts to fade into the background. You start concentrating more on the work at hand. And finally, we want to look at responding to change or blindly following a plan. So we want to respond to our customers' needs. And we'll talk a little bit more about this later, but we don't want to force them into our customers into some sort of formal change control where it's very painful. We want to make sure that we're delivering and responding to their needs as their business is changing, and this goes for external and internal customers, as opposed to following a plan. And yes, I am a PMI, PMP. It's taught me a lot of things, but the one thing that I've learned is that creating a master schedule with a Gantt chart and the dependencies, doing critical path analysis and resource leveling and all that, that on an Agile project really is not so important because you're not focusing so much on the plan and the completion of tasks as you are the delivery. You're focusing more on an Agile project on the completion of value, which is that working code. Agile is also 12 principles. I'm not going to run through this. This is also available to you at agilemanifesto.org. Again, I encourage you to go out and read this. There's a lot of good stuff out there. Very basic, but very, very meaningful. All right. So Agile is an umbrella word. No, the rumors are not true. Agile is not Scrum. Scrum is a method under the Agile umbrella, just as Kanban, Lean, FDD is feature-driven development, Crystal, and XP down here, which is extreme programming. Been a lot of talk in the industry about, especially in enterprise environments, that Agile is Scrum and it is not. Just keep that in mind. It's more of a philosophy in a way that we do our work. It's not a specific. You would not say the Agile methodology. Please be aware of that. Scrum is an Agile method among many. And it's okay to experiment, to find what's right for you. Experiment among many of these and find the right combination that's right for your organization. All right, so what I want to do now is start talking about some myths. One of the myths around Agile is that it's for software only. Well, that's not the case. Here's an example of our team, the Agile Services team. You can see Katie is in the background, Angie's on the right, and myself on the left. And that's our task board, Kanban board, whatever you want to call it. We're not doing Scrum. It's more of a Kanban method. But none of that work that's on that board is software development. It's all work driven by our deliverables. So whether it's deliverables for a client or something that we're developing internally, all that work gets managed on that board. The colored dots just mean either it's the person that the work is getting done by, or if it's got a red dot on it, that just means it's a block. But as you can see, that it's Agile is not just for software. So we busted that myth. Agile is nothing but cowboy coding. Well, we know that Agile engineering practices are disciplined with test-driven development, pair programming, continuous integration, and refactoring. So in many ways, Agile engineering practices will be more disciplined because the team's going to be communicating on a daily basis. They're going to be checking in code with continuous integration. They're going to be checking in code daily, and they're going to find the weak spot soon, and they'll be able to make that code more robust. So we know that the engineering practices that we see with Agile methods are very, very robust and much more disciplined. So we busted that myth. No documentation. Documentation is on an Agile project is done on a just-in-time basis. Why write documentation for something you may not even develop? We know it happens on a project, on a waterfall project. Some things get dropped off. Well, if we've already created the documentation for it, that was a worthless effort because that documentation is not going to get used. So we only want to use or create documentation as required to meet the customer needs. And as far as government agencies are concerned, keep an eye on to the regulations, because the regulations are changing. They're changing with future regulations to allow more flexibility in the amount of documentation that's required. So we busted that myth. Agile methods lack planning. Well, we know this is not true, right? It's been said that Agile methods don't plan up front, so the outcome is predictable. Well, actually, depending on the project, there may be some upfront planning, but detailed planning is reserved for the start of the iteration that work begins in. Planning is done more frequently as the project progresses and is more predictable because development is done in small chunks. The mindset is we know more today than we knew yesterday, so we want to use that information to plan accordingly, not try to plan everything up front and then develop and not be able to react to some of the changes that come on down the line. So Agile methods allow us to get a little bit more predictability because we're planning more frequently. So we busted that myth. Agile methods don't scale. Yeah, the truth is that I've worked on many large projects with distributed teams. My first project was working in Romania with teams in the U.S. and Turkey. I've worked with teams in Russia and Philippines and various other places. And these were, waterfall projects, and I've worked on rationally fed process projects. No matter what SDLC you use or delivery process you use, all projects have issues with scaling. You're always going to have issues. Once you move beyond that small team, you're going to have an issue with scaling. Whether it's moving from co-location to distributed, small or large team, or both, scaling Agile is possible, but it does require trade-offs, such as losing face-to-face communication and co-location advantages for geographically dispersed teams. So we busted that myth. Agile leads to reduced quality. Again, as I mentioned before, quality is a loaded word. So there's quality of code, but also quality of documentation, fitness for use, and so on. In short, everyone on an Agile team is responsible for quality, as we'll see. So the levels of quality on an Agile team are often higher than those on traditional team. We can't just throw things over the wall to the next team and the next phase. The team's going to be working together, and we'll talk briefly about that shortly, but everyone on that team is responsible for quality, no matter what kind of quality it is. So we busted that myth. And then, of course, Agile is just a fad, right? I've heard that quite a bit. It's like RAD or JAD or any of these other things that have come along. Agile is a fad. Well, the fact is it was born in the 90s, documented in 2001 with the Agile Manifesto, and has been growing ever since. And I think what we want to get to is that, Agile is, it's not where it's Agile development versus traditional or waterfall or rationing by process or whatever. It's just software development. So Agile is a name we can use, we can hang a hat on, but eventually we want to get to a point where the way we go about organizing teams and developing software, developing products in general, the Agile way, but that we don't need to call it Agile anymore. So we've busted that myth. All right, so let's talk about why Agile. So here's an often cited maybe too often cited report from the Standards Group. It's the Chaos Report. You got results here from 2004, 2006, and 2009. If you look at the results, just over a quarter of projects succeed, and we'll talk about a little bit more in depth about what that means to be successful. They're talking more in terms of a traditional iron triangle, which we'll talk about next. For their success criteria, 32% or just over 25% succeeded, whereas almost three quarters were either failed or challenged. That is representative from 2004, 2006, and 2009. Let's investigate what they mean by success. Well, when the Standards Group defines success, they were talking about a traditional iron triangle. And if you're a student of the Project Management Institute, or you know, you're a PMP, you're going to know this very well. It's often called the triple constraint. There's three binding angles here for a project. There's scope, cost, and schedule. And success for a Standards Group is within scope, right? We're going to have a fixed amount of scope for, you know, we're going to deliver that in a certain time frame, so that's schedule, and then under a certain amount of cost. So that's called the triple constraint or the traditional iron triangle. And on a traditional project, scope drives both cost and schedule. So we have a fixed amount of scope, X, cost Y, and schedule Z. And generally, schedule is the highest priority on that. But however, you know, whatever gets adjusted along the edges of this triangle, quality can be impacted. That's why quality is in the center. And that's why the arrow is pointing down from scope, because we know that on a traditional project, scope drives cost and schedule. Now, if we take that a step further and we look at the Agile Iron Triangle, we see that the edges are the same. We have cost, schedule, and scope. Yet on an Agile project, cost and schedule drive scope. What we see are the success factors are the same, but the drivers are different. So if you hear that an Agile project has scope creep, that should raise a red flag for you, because scope is not fixed on an Agile project. A customer is going to be able to continually reprioritize their requirements, that scope, throughout the project. You know, there's not this big lump of scope that must be delivered that we're basing cost and schedule off of. What we see on an Agile Iron Triangle is that cost and schedule drive scope. So we have a certain amount of budget, and we need to deliver something by this time frame, and that scope is going to be variable depending on those two items. Let's take it a step further. Now, Jim Highsmith, who is one of the thought leaders in the industry on Agile, he's written several books. He's proposed the Agile Triangle, and as you can see here, he puts cost, schedule, and scope as a constraint on one of the edges, but then he also counts value and quality as the other edges, which, you know, is how we determine success on a project. So value meaning that delivering real value, real business value through a releasable product that we can release regularly, rather than just a bunch of documentation. We're releasing regularly with business value in mind. On the quality side, we have that it's reliable. So once it's in the customer's hands, is it reliable? Can it, you know, does it serve its purpose? Is it for use? And then also, you know, adaptable products. So quality also speaks to the fact that whenever we do update it, so if we are, you know, on an Agile project and we're pushing releases out, let's say once a quarter or, you know, every few weeks, every time we go in and update that product, that it's going to be easily adaptable. So we have, you know, loosely coupled technology that's easily adaptable. So this is a traditional waterfall cycle, and I could name quite a few things that is wrong with this. You know, why we should not be delivering software in this fashion. But because this is the business case and we are talking about the business case, which usually focuses on money, I want to keep it at that level. Imagine that you were to go to your project manager, or maybe you're a project manager and your executive comes to you and they say, you know, we need to take advantage of a market opportunity, or we need to divert funding from this project to another higher priority initiative. If you're operating under a traditional waterfall, what are you going to do? Let's say 6 months into a year-long project, your executive comes to you and asks you this question. Well, you're still in design. You're in design phase. So your executive's telling you, you know, show me the money, and you can't, because all you have up until this time is documentation. You've written no code. You've tested no code. You've put nothing into operations that can get you a return on that investment. So up until this point, it's really sunk cost. If you were to want to divert funding to another project, well, for the benefit of the organization, you know, that's going to be a difficult decision to make. Let's say this is $100,000, or let's say it's $1 million project, and you've spent $500,000 up to this point. Well, it's very hard to, you know, that mentality of we've spent $500,000 so far, we can't stop now, that will start to set in. You know, making those tough decisions becomes much harder because you really haven't pushed anything into production that provides any value. Again, all you have up until this point is documentation. Therefore, traditional organizations cannot be as flexible as agile organizations. It's just not possible. No, you can't show your executive the money, or your project manager can't show you the money. Traditional methods, as you can see here, you know, we've got, and I should have put this in here, but when I say requirements, I mean the big requirements up front with the, you know, the big stacks of the binders. We've got big requirements up front, big design up front. And if you don't think this happens, trust me, it does, and maybe it probably happened more a few years ago, but I still see this in organizations today. And I can remember, you know, when I worked in Romania shortly after 9/11, we were walking through with our big design doc, and we got pulled over by airport security in Germany. And we were held in security for almost an hour while they went through literally almost page by page, you know, we were trying to convince them that this wasn't something to create a bomb out of, but this document was that thick. That's what, you know, waterfall or traditional methods do, is they make us provide these big requirements, big design documents up front. Well, what does that lead us to? It leads us to a rigid change control process. You've got the change control board. Anytime a customer wants a change, they've got to push it through the change control board, and then we make them sign in blood and go through this very painful process of just getting a change approved when really they're trying to build the best application that meets their needs. So we force them through this rigid change control process, which leads to an unhappy customer, and that's unfortunate. You know, I don't know why we've done this in the past, and certainly with agile projects, we'll see that, you know, change is introduced at regular intervals and not going through a formal change control process so that we can focus on keeping the customer happy and delivering business value. So let's talk about agile, iterative, and incremental. And assume that these iterations are 4 weeks. So each number is an iteration. So we have iteration 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Each block in each iteration is a section of releasable code. So this is something that can be released to production. You may not choose to release it every 4 weeks, but it's possible. When you can do that, let's say you do release every 4 weeks. What you start to notice is that when you start to put these things in to production, you start getting value back. Maybe you've automated for an internal customer. Maybe they're using new functionality and you've automated a previously manual process. So now they're more efficient and they're more happier. An organization may be using the new functionality to gain a competitive advantage. External customer may be doing the same thing. The big difference between this and a traditional or waterfall approach is that we can start earning money back on that investment as quickly as possible, as soon as a few weeks. So yes, when your manager comes to you, or you go to your, you know, as an executive or a manager, and they come to you and you say, show me the money, yes, you can show them the money. Because now, if we assume that 6 months or 6 sprints or iterations into the project, we need to divert that funding elsewhere, we can do that. We may need a few extra weeks just to bundle everything up, but since we've already been putting code into production, we can wrap things up and re-divert that funding elsewhere to the organization to concentrate on higher priority initiatives. So what's in an iteration? Well, here's an iteration. This assumes 4 weeks. On day one, we have release and iteration planning. Day 2 through 19, we have development, which includes all the typical activities. Now, this is not a waterfall approach within this iteration. This is more of a stacked approach, because work's going to be handed back backwards and forwards between design and code and test, and you know, your analysts maybe writing some requirements in there. But this is happening daily, so it's more of a stacked process as opposed to a waterfall-type process within this iteration. So this happens days 2 through 19. Every day we're having a stand-up, and we're including the customer in on this daily stand-up, no more than 15 minutes, talking about how things are going. That's part of what we call the inspect and adapt cycle. So, you know, we want to see how we're doing today and be able to adapt based on that feedback that we're getting, not only from the development team, but also from the customer. Day 20, we have a retrospective and a review where we show what we've delivered in that iteration, and then we have a retrospective to talk about how things went and then how we can improve the process going forward for the project and for the iteration. This iteration is what we saw on the previous slide. Each iteration, this is what's happening. Now I want to talk about self-organizing teams. A traditional team, you'll see where we have a project manager and a team lead on top, and generally junior developers and other folks on the bottom. A project manager, you know, they worry about, you know, the critical path analysis and their Gantt chart and managing tasks and assigning them and all that. And a team lead generally may even assign the hours for the developers that are working on the project. So they may actually, you know, work with the project manager to schedule and give estimates for the hours and all that. On an Agile team, what we see is, and I'm showing this in red here, is that, you know, the Agile team really takes on a lot of the team lead and project manager responsibility because they're providing their own estimates. They're talking to each other. Whenever a new feature comes up, you know, they talk about it. They have, you know, communication, how they see each feature and what it's going to take to deliver it. They create their own tasks, and we're not going to talk too much about a burn down, but they create what's called a burn down to track their progress, which is a secondary indicator, by the way. Your daily scrum should be your primary indicator of progress, but each team member on an Agile team takes these responsibilities on. So they're responsible for their own estimates and responsible for their progress. And then you see the emergence of the servant leader or the facilitator, which could be a team member or it could not be. It could be a full-time person that maybe is on other projects as well. Part of their job with this team is to help facilitate their needs and make sure that, you know, they have everything they need to succeed. So it's a very empowering environment because your team is feeling like they're being listened to and they're able to work these, you know, issues out themselves. So it's about feedback, right? With Agile processes, we want to make sure that, you know, empirically we want to know that we're delivering the right thing for the customer. So daily we're talking to them. Every time we have our, you know, our iteration review, we're showing them the product, and, you know, that's every few weeks, and we want to know that we're delivering the right thing empirically. And we want to know that our assumptions about what will work actually work. So, you know, in a traditional project, we make all these assumptions, design decisions and everything, and then when it comes down to coding, and I've been on projects like this too, where we have ivory tower architects, and the architecture comes down from on high, but when it comes to the actual implementation, you know, you can't really, it's not a workable solution. So you got to go back to the drawing board. And we see that, we see that with traditional projects, but with iterative projects, where in Agile projects, we're hashing those issues out right away, daily, and within the iteration, because people are communicating with each other. So we want to make sure from a technical perspective that, you know, we're getting that feedback, and then from our customer that we're delivering the right thing. It's also about managing risk. Agile, you might recognize our Tiki here. He's from our Agile expedition. He's helping us out here to illustrate waterfall risk. But waterfall risk is pushed out in time over the course of the project because we haven't produced anything that's any tangible code or anything that we can show to a customer that would operate in a production environment. So because of that, all we have up until, you know, and assuming a year-long project, up until about midpoint or a little beyond, is a bunch of documentation. And we don't start reducing risk until we actually start putting that documentation into the code and testing it. That's why I have iterative risk here. It should really just be agile, you know, iterative incremental risk. But we start reducing risk right away as soon as a few weeks, because we're producing production-ready code as soon as possible, and as, you know, as little as a few weeks. So we're proving our assumptions through the code. Let's talk about some changes, and these are just some observations I've made. These are not all-inclusive, so if you think there are a few more that need to be added, please feel free to let me know. This is by no means an all-inclusive list. But team changes. Teams adopt a more customer-centric view, right? The customer is in the driver's seat and active on the project daily. So the team is delivering real value for the customer, and they're talking to them daily. They're getting that feedback that they need, and so they're developing this relationship. And I've seen instances where the relationship is so good that maybe we were supposed to release every two iterations, but we decided to push a release because, you know, the customer wanted to add some additional functionality that would make it even more valuable to the users. You know, that kind of relationship, is, in my opinion, makes for a very positive work environment. Remember, that's what we want. We want to create a very good work environment for our employees where they feel like they're valued and we're delivering value. Teams become more quality-focused because, you know, they're building quality product rather than just components and tossing them over the wall. You know, we see that in traditional methods all the time. It's more componentized. We're tossing these things over the wall to the next person. You know, the focus is less on the quality, whereas in an Agile team, you know, the team's working together, and if they don't, at the end of that iteration, if they don't produce a quality product, well, you know, everybody's going to hear about it. There's no real one throat to choke on that. We see the rise of the self-directed and self-organizing team. So the team is empowered to make the best decision for the best outcome. This goes with the process, right? We don't want that dictated process from on high. We want to make sure that the team is allowed to make the right process decisions for themselves so that they can make the best decisions for the organization on how to deliver that product. And then we also see the emergence of the servant leader. So command and control gives way to facilitation. You know, how this plays out will depend on your organization. It really does depend. There's no one formula for this. And enterprise changes. So the business and IT become more collaborative, right? They start working for the same goal because they're working together daily on solving problems that affect the organization. Hopefully you've been on projects where you've seen the customer or product owner, product manager, they toss something over the wall and then they leave it to IT to deliver, and then they get to come back and 6 months, 7 months, 8 months, and complain about what IT delivered when there was no communication in between. What we start to see in the enterprise is the business and IT really become more collaborative, and they start talking more, and they have a better relationship and start delivering on organizational goals rather than their own agendas individually. Funding projects becomes incremental. So now that we're able to deliver, let's say we're pushing code to production, even at the least we're pushing the code every quarter. If we're pushing every quarter, then now we can evaluate, is this project worth continuing on? So maybe in that first release we've gotten the minimal value that we need, and now we know more, you know, 3 months in or one quarter in than we did 3 or 4 months ago, and we have higher priority initiatives, we want to divert funding. So we can fund projects incrementally based on our ability to deliver incrementally. And the same goes for product portfolio, where the product portfolio becomes more optimized because now we can pick the winners and the losers much, much sooner and divert those financial resources to the higher priority initiatives much sooner. Killing underperforming projects or obsolete projects becomes easier, reducing the likelihood of zombie projects. And then, of course, the feedback loops shorten. So problems within the portfolio, the project portfolio or product portfolio, are identified much, much earlier. All right, so now what I want to do is share a parting thought with you as we're about to wrap up here. So a little over a year ago, I was on a project for a client of mine where it was an $800,000 project, and my client happened to meet with their customers. This was they had a customer summit. We're talking multi-million dollar customers here. And when at the summit, their customers told them that, you know, you guys have been sending us invoices piecemeal. You know, you're sending us a bunch of invoices. We want them to be consolidated because it costs us a lot of time and money on our end to consolidate these invoices to pay for your services. We shouldn't have to do that. you know, if you don't consolidate those invoices, well, then we're gonna take our business elsewhere. So keep in mind, this is a, you know, multi-million dollars worth of business for my client. They came back from that customer summit and they reached out to the projects because we were already almost three quarters of the way through the year. The project budgets had been doled out. They budgeted for their projects annually. So the next budgeting cycle wasn't going to be coming through for another few months. And they reached out to the projects and they said, hey, if you've got budget available, give it back to us because we've got a very high priority initiative that we need to start right away and we need to fund it. Well, we had waterfall projects and agile projects within the organization. My project happened to be an agile project. We had been delivering code to production for several months. We had delivered the value that this product and this project had intended. And we were fortunate enough to be able to hand back almost $200,000 to the organization so that they could divert that funding to this, what they ended up calling the Consolidated Invoicing Initiative. And think about that. I mean, that's an $800,000 project. That's almost a quarter of the budget, $200,000 to divert elsewhere into the organization. That's significant. That's not chump change. That's, you know, for me, I think that's really where I woke up and saw that, you know, Agile is more than just delivering code sooner. It really is about organizational survival, because in this instance, we were able to let the company proceed, you know, ahead of their regular funding cycle with this high priority project. And they were able to get some additional funding from some of the other Agile projects. The waterfall projects, guess where they were at, right? They're still coding. They're still in the testing phase. So nothing of real value has been delivered. You know, they're still giving excuses like, we can't do that because we're still in testing phase. Just keep that in mind. And that's my parting thought for you all.